Yeah. Today's topic is suppositories and pessaries. Yesterday we have already discussed about this topic, but today again, as there are more participants in the group, again I will be having a revision on the same topic again. Okay. Yeah, let us go on to the topic. Yeah, first coming to the definition of suppositories. A suppository is a medicated solid form usually intended for use in the rectum, vagina, and to a lesser extent the urethra. After insertion, they melt or soften at body temperature, whereas vaginal suppositories, sometimes called as pessaries, are also made as compressed tablets that disintegrate into body fluids. In a simple way, in order to define suppository, what do you mean by suppository? Suppositories are solid dosage forms which contain API and other ingredients intended for rectal administration, vaginal administration, urethral administration for desired therapeutic effect. This is the definition normally what we see. But according to USP, what do you mean by USP? USP is nothing but United States Pharmacopoeia. Here, normally when we had a discussion about suppositories, we say that there are different kinds of suppositories. There are vaginal suppositories, there are rectal suppositories, there are something called as urethral suppositories. According to USP, the nomenclature is wrong. Suppositories, according to USP, can be defined as: suppositories are solid bodies of various sizes and shapes adapted for introduction into the rectum. They are formulated to melt, soften, or dissolve at body temperature. The drug substance contained in the suppository may act locally or systematically absorbed. The term suppository shall not be used for products inserted into other body cavities. Whenever you use this terminology called as suppositories, suppositories are meant for only rectal administration. So this particular terminology suppository cannot be used for any type of substance that is inserted into the body cavity. Only for the rectal administration you can use the terminology called as suppository. Yesterday when we had a discussion, we have discussed something like there are different types of suppositories. When you say vaginal suppositories, that are called as pessaries. When you say urethral suppositories, that are called as bogies. So different terminologies we have mentioned over there. So nowhere you are going to make a statement that urethral bogies are something called as suppositories. Pessaries are something called as suppositories. Both are not same. Okay, keep that in mind. Suppository, when we will use this terminology called suppository, only whenever a particular substance that is inserted into the rectal cavity, then only you are allowed to use a terminology called as suppository. Other than that, anything that is inserted into any of your cavities of your body. What are the cavities that are present in the body? Rectal cavity, vaginal cavity, urethral cavity, ear cavity, nasal cavity. These are the different types of cavities that are present in the body. A particular substance that is inserted into the rectal cavity, then only you can call that particular substance or that particular type of dosage form as suppository. Other than that, anything that is inserted into any cavity except your rectal cavity, that particular dosage forms are not called as suppositories. They are called under a broad classification called as inserts, I-N-S-E-R-T-S. They are something called as inserts. Under inserts, you will be having this pessaries, bogies, ear cones, etc. Under inserts, you will be having the type of dosage forms like your pessaries, bogies. Yesterday, do you remember we have discussed something about urethral bogies? We have discussed something about ear cones. Do you remember? So that particular type of dosage forms will come under the category of inserts, but will not come under the category of suppositories. But if you can see your library books or any literature you found in the net, you will be seeing this particular bogies, ear cones and all will be discussed under a common topic called as suppository. Why? What is the reason? Do you know the reason is the base used or the principle used in the preparation of such type of dosage forms, either your bogies, either your suppositories, either your cones, ear cones or dental cones, whatever it is, the principle used in the preparation is same. What is the principle? Normally you will be having some base melted. To that base you will be adding your API, then you will be heating at a higher temperature, then you will cool it, then you will put it into some molds. Same principle will be involved in the preparation of your suppositories, your bogies, your pessaries, as well as your cones. As same principle is involved, people are considering that these are something nothing but called as suppository. But according to USP, it is wrong. So whenever a person is asking that what are these nasal bogies, what are these pessaries, simply they will say that suppositories. Now you ask a question to the person, in what way you call that pessaries as suppositories? It is wrong. According to USP nomenclature, suppositories terminology will be given to a dosage form that is inserted only through rectal route. Okay, is it clear? This is very important, ma. There are some really important things to be understood, ma. Even the people who have completed their masters, who have completed their PhDs, they lack understanding in knowing some minute things. As like your surface tension, I have explained very well about surface tension in your previous classes and all. In the same way, such concepts are, they look like very simple concepts, but these particular concepts are very important to us. Next, coming to the definition of pessaries. Pessaries are single dose preparations. They have various shape, usually ovoid with a volume and consistency suitable or insertion into vagina. They contain one or more active substances dispersed or dissolved in suitable bases that may be soluble or dispersible or melted body temperature. Throughout this definition, is there any point they have mentioned something about suppository here? No, they have told like these are single dose preparation. They contain API, one or more APIs which are present in dispersed state or dissolved state in a suitable basis. They are intended for insertion into the vagina. Something that have been inserted into the vagina, such kind of dosage forms are called as pessaries. Something that are inserted into rectum, such type of dosage forms are called as suppositories. Something that have been inserted into urethral cavity, that kind of dosage forms are called as bogies. Something that have been inserted into ear, that are called as cones, ear cones. Okay, so what happens when you insert something into the rectum? So the first step that happens is that particular substance will start melting. After melting, what happens ultimately? It will get softened. After softened, what happens ultimately? It will get dissolved. After dissolving, what happens? Ultimately, it will just permeate through the mucous membrane that is present in rectal cavity. And after permeating that mucous membrane, it will directly enters into your systemic circulation. This is exactly what happens in the rectum. Just it is something like imaginary kind of a thing. You imagine like there is some cavity. Inside that cavity, that particular cavity is nothing but called as, it resembles your rectum. When you place a suppository into that cavity, initial step it melts. After that it softens, thereby it will get dissolved, thereby it will permeate through the mucous membrane surrounding your cavity. After permeating that mucous membrane, it will directly enters into your systemic circulation. This is about the definition about your suppository and pessaries. Next, coming to the advantages of suppositories and pessaries. So all your advantages and disadvantages we will be discussing in common for suppositories and pessaries. Why we will be discussing in common? The reason is that the principle involved in the suppositories and pessaries is same. So what the basis involved in your suppositories and pessaries is same. So the question you may come across in your examination, it might be either suppository, it might be either pessary. Whatever the question is, the answer would be the same. The only thing you need to use your common sense is that when the question is asked about pessaries, you need to just replace the word of suppository with pessaries. When the question is asked about pessaries, you need to replace the word about pessaries with suppositories. This is what you are going to do. Now coming to the advantages of suppositories and pessaries. So, yeah, the first advantage is for the drugs where oral route is not useful, for such particular type of drugs, you can opt for suppositories. Okay, see, first, there are some drugs, it might be any reason, they might be sensitive to acidic pH, they might not be having enough bioavailability. For such type of drugs which comes under the category where oral route is not useful, then you can just shift on to alternative route called as suppositories. Can you see, I have given it as a, what we can say, pictorial presentation. So first in the blue color, oral route is not useful. That is the first advantage. You can frame your sentences accordingly. Okay. And what is the second advantage? For the patient where GIT problems, nausea or post-operative conditions are there. For such particular type of patients, you can opt for suppositories. The first one, a patient suffering from GIT problems. What do you mean by GIT problems? Gastrointestinal. It might be stomach ulcers. It might be intestinal infections. Whatever might be the condition. In such conditions, you cannot go for oral administration. In that case, you can just shift on to suppositories. A particular patient suffering from nausea and vomiting. In that conditions also, you can shift on to alternative dosage form called as suppository. A particular patient has undergone some operation. After post operation, if you want to give some medication, ultimately in that particular conditions also, you can go for shifting on to alternative dosage form called as suppository. Coming to the third advantage. Patients who are very young, very old, or mentally disturbed. In that conditions also, you can opt for suppositories. When you say very young, it is a layman language, pediatrics you can say. In the case of pediatrics, you can just shift on to an alternative dosage form called as suppository. Why you need to shift on to alternate dosage form called suppository? Because the problem with the pediatrics is that they will be having difficulty in swallowing. So for such condition, you need to go for suppositories. Very old, again it's a layman language here. In the case of geriatrics, ultimately there will be a difficulty in swallowing. For such conditions, you can go for shifting on to alternative dosage form called as suppository. And the people who are mentally disturbed, it is very difficult for the person who is mentally disturbed, he cannot take the medication orally because they will not listen to our words. And they will be in an irritated mode. In such conditions, when that particular patient is in unconscious condition, in that particular condition, you can just insert the suppository into the rectum. Thereby you will be opting an alternative dosage form called as suppository. Now coming to the next advantage, drugs having GI side effects. So there are some drugs which degrade in your stomach pH as well as your intestinal pH. There are some drugs which will produce some side effects. So in your stomach as well as intestinal region. Have you heard about some terms called as stomach ulcers, intestinal ulcers? Okay. There are some drugs which cause these ulcers. In such conditions, you can opt for an alternative dosage form called as suppositories. Next, drugs not stable at GI pH or susceptible to enzymatic attack in the GI tracts. There are some drugs in the market that are not stable in the GI pH. So always you take a medication to expect 100% therapeutic effect. But some drugs, due to the acidic pH, the drugs start getting degraded in the GI pH. In such conditions, you can go for suppositories. There are some drugs that are susceptible to enzymatic attack. You know that stomach will contain some enzymes and your intestine will contain some enzymes. These enzymes will start degrading your API immediately after entering into your intestine. In such conditions also, you can opt for alternative dosage form called as suppositories. Next, drugs that has first pass metabolism, for such particular type of drugs also you can opt for suppositories. What do you mean by first pass metabolism? Point of entry through oral administration to stomach, followed by intestine towards your liver. Any drug you expect what? 100% therapeutic effect. But there are some drugs, there is a chance that they may degrade in your stomach, they may degrade in your intestine, they may degrade in your liver. The outcome of the drug might be 40% bioavailable or 50% bioavailable. What we expect is 100%. If this particular condition happens where the drug comes from the liver having only 40 to 50% bioavailability, then such particular type of drugs are prone to first pass metabolism. In that conditions also, you need to opt for alternative type of dosage form called as what? Suppositories. Okay. And next thing is, drugs with an unacceptable taste can be administered. There are some drugs where the taste of the drug, we know that API will be bitter in nature, but to a little extent that bitterness can be acceptable. But when the bitterness is very high, we cannot accept through oral administration. In that conditions also, you can opt for an alternative type of dosage form called as suppositories. Next, drugs that may be abused as in suicide. This is very important one. See, sleeping tablets and the drugs that are containing codeine, drugs that are containing morphine, drugs that are containing heroin. Okay. So this particular type of drugs which are meant for oral administration, a particular patient will go and he will refill the prescription with 5 tablets of morphine. Okay. So this particular 5 tablets has been prescribed to the patient for some disease condition, but he may abuse that particular tablets. But the same API, when it is formulated in the form of suppositories, no way he can abuse that particular type of drugs. This is the way how these people are very clever, formulators are very clever in formulating the drugs in the form of suppositories. See, if it is given in a oral administration, what you can do? You can just have a habituation of that particular drugs and it will result in suicide condition. But the same drugs, when it has been given through rectal administration, there is no way that you will get habituated to such particular drugs. This is the one more advantage of the drugs that may be abused as in suicide. And next, coming to the disadvantages. Okay, I hope everyone understood about the advantages of your dosage form suppositories. Next, we will move on to disadvantages. So whatever might be the dosage form, when there is a good in that, ultimately you will be having a bad part for that particular type of dosage form. It might be parenteral, it might be tablet, it might be suppository, it might be liquid. Where there are advantages, definitely you will be having some disadvantages associated with that. So what are the disadvantages? So the first disadvantage is mucosal irritation. Mucosal irritation. As I told you that your rectal cavity is rich in mucosa. Okay. So if the dose is too high or too lower, it results in mucosal irritation. That is the first disadvantage. Next, second one, traditional issues, feeling of aversion. So traditional issues, when you say traditionally, we don't want a suppository that to going to one room, closing the door and just inserting particular suppository into our rectum. We don't need this. We need something that is nice. Some content so that easily you can take the tablet and you can administer. These are something called as traditional issues. Feeling of aversion. What do you mean by feeling of aversion? Strong dislike or discomfort towards the dosage form is called as aversion. Strong dislike or discomfort towards the dosage form is called as aversion. Anyone who come across this suppository, ultimately you will show some dislike or discomfort towards the suppository. Definitely you will ask the physician, is it really necessary to take this suppository medication? Then the physician will ask you, why, what is the problem? Because you know, is there any alternative to suppository that can be taken orally? This is a question we ask to the physician. But for such diseases like your rectal infections, vaginal infections, urethral infections, it is mandatory to go for suppositories and pessaries. So feeling of aversion is one disadvantage. Next, leakage problem. So after taking from the packet, so for administration of suppositories, every person should have something called as patient education, because all the people will not be aware of suppositories. A particular patient education should be provided. Why? Because these suppositories will look like a tablet. Ultimately, when we don't have patient education, what we will do? As usual, we'll open the strip and we'll take that suppository and we'll go for oral administration. Here, there's a point of patient education is required. And apart from that, okay, you know that it is meant for rectal administration. The next step, after opening the container, you need to take the suppository from the container. After taking from the container, what you need to do? Immediately, you need to insert into the rectal cavity. If you wait for some time, what happens? Due to the temperature that is present outside, it will result in melting your suppository. So that is nothing but a leakage problem associated with suppository. So try to buy one suppository and just take from the container and just catch it in your hand. Within seconds, it will start leaking. Okay. So that is nothing but a disadvantage associated with suppository. The same problem you cannot expect with the tablets. Yes or no? The same problem you cannot expect with the capsules. Okay, whatever time you leave it for some time outside, towards the outside temperature, it will be safe. There will be no leakage from tablets and capsules. But in the case of suppository, you expect leakage problems. Next, sometimes incomplete absorption. So you will think that you have been inserted that suppository into the rectum, but you cannot ensure that it has been completely inserted. Sometimes half of the suppository may be inside your rectum and half of the suppository will be outside the rectum. Here it will be showing something called as incomplete absorption. Okay. Next, inter and intra subject variation. Very excellent and important concept, ma. Inter and intra subject. A particular drug that works on one human being will not be showing same kind of effect on the other one. Okay, this is nothing but inter and intra subject variation. Okay, it is very important that, see, a subject is there. To A subject, I have given 500 mg paracetamol. Okay, and I have taken a B subject, and to the B subject, I have given the same paracetamol. You cannot ensure that this particular 500 mg paracetamol will work on the same A and B subjects at an equal rate. No, it will never happen. This is something called as inter and inter subject variation. Okay, there are some drugs which will provide one kind of effect in one person, and on the other person it will show different kind of effect. Okay, we need to be very careful in prescribing these suppositories to the patient. That is other disadvantage. Next, proctitis. The next disadvantage is proctitis. It is a new terminology. Make a note. Proctitis is nothing but inflammation of the anus. Proctitis is nothing but inflammation of anus. So the suppository sizes will not be equal. It may range from 1 gram to 4 gram and it may range from 1 gram to 8 grams also. In that conditions, you know, when your rectal cavity is not in a position to take up the suppository, ultimately it will end up in inflammation of anus. Okay, proctitis is nothing but inflammation of anus. Next disadvantage is large scale production is difficult and costly. Unlike your tablets, it is not easy to go for large scale production of your suppositories. You know the difficulty. If people, you would have performed the suppository experiment in the laboratory, you know the difficulty, how difficult it is. You need to melt it immediately, you need to cool it. This is what the steps involved in the preparation of suppositories. It is not that much easy like your tablets. In tablets, what you will do? You will take different types of ingredients, you will mix it in a bowl and just you will put it into a compression machine, you will compress the tablets. 1 hour, 4,000, 10,000 tablets also you can compress, but it is not possible with the suppositories. And the cost of suppository is costly. One suppository will cost about 35 to 40 rupees minimum, but one tablet will cost about 3 to 4 rupees. Okay, this is the other disadvantage on the other side. And next, shelf life stringent storage conditions to be maintained. It is very difficult to maintain shelf life for suppositories, and stringent storage conditions should be maintained for suppositories. Have you ever bought suppository? Just on trial basis, you buy one suppository and go to a medical shop and ask for suppository. Check with the storage condition. It has to be stored in a refrigerated condition. Okay, always the suppositories will be in the refrigerator. A medical shop without refrigerator will not be there. Why? Because for storing such type of suppositories, even the antibiotic should be stored in the refrigerator. These are nothing but stringent storage conditions. That's the reason while preparing your products, while preparing your labels, so always I'll be stressing on storage conditions. That is a very important aspect for your dosage form. It is not like whatever the way you want to store, it is not like storing your dosage forms. Okay, some stringent storage conditions should be followed for dosage forms. Next, gastrointestinal state affects absorption. There is some other thing called as the state of your gastrointestinal tract. So always keep something in mind when you say gastrointestinal tract, it will start from your esophagus and it will end at your anus. So this is the throughout the length. This is something called as gastrointestinal tract. Okay, when you say that, the state of gastrointestinal tract is also very important. As I told you yesterday, like, so there is an bowel movement in, you have placed the suppository and there is a bowel movement. Then what happens? Whatever you have placed inside for expecting some therapeutic effect, it will not be achieved due to that bowel movement. The state of gastrointestinal absorption is also very important. You need to ensure that the bowel evacuation of bowel movement has been completed. Now that particular area is ready for absorption of your suppository. You need to ensure and you need to place the suppository. Clear? These are the disadvantages and advantages of your suppository. Dear students, please listen. I have forwarded some PDF files of all your units to Shruti. Just collect that PDF files from there. Okay, so all these things, whatever I explain through slides, will be in your PDF. Just start studying, you will understand, and you can prepare some notes from the slides also. No need of reading from the PDF also. Just you can rely on the slides. Okay, next, going on to the types of suppositories. Okay, so what I told you, these are not types of suppositories. So when we use the terminology called suppositories, anything that is inserted into the rectum, then only you are allowed to use a terminology called as suppositories. But according to your old versions of your books and all, it has been given the types of suppositories. Just have a glance: rectal suppositories, pessaries, urethral bogies, nasal bogies, ear cones. Okay, so anything that is inserted into body cavity called ear, they are called as ear cones. Anything that are inserted into your nasal cavity, that are called as bogies. Anything that is inserted into urethral cavity, that are also called as bogies. Anything that is inserted into the vagina, that are called as pessaries. Anything that is inserted into the rectum, that are called as rectal suppositories. According to the weight, there are different types: 1 to 2 gram, 1 to 4 gram, small 1 gram for infants, medium 2 grams for children, large 4 grams for adults. Okay, these are the different weights, and you have shapes like conical shape, rod shape, wedge shape and oval shape. These are for your rectal suppositories. When coming to the pessaries, the weight will range from 4 to 8 grams. Okay, and the base will be glycerogelatin base, and the shape will be spherical and oval. Urethral bogies, the weight will be around 2 to 4 grams, length about 8 centimeters, and the base will be glycerogelatin base. Okay, and the shapes are something like long, thin, cylindrical forms. Next, coming to your nasal bogies, the weights will be around 1 gram and the size will be around 9 to 10 centimeter long, and the base used is cocoa butter and the shape is thin and cylindrical. Okay, and next, ear cones, the weight will be around 1 gram and the size 8 to 10 centimeter long, and the base is cocoa butter and the shape is cylindrical shape. Okay, thin cylindrical shape. Yeah, these are the images for your suppositories, different types of suppositories. Can you see the first image? You have round oval suppository, long oval, teardrop, bullet shape. Bullet shape nothing but called as torpedo shape, tampon shape. And below you can see some different types of shapes, right? These are nothing but called as only the shape of the suppository will be torpedo shape. Keep this thing in mind, okay? But when the shape is asked about your pessaries and your nasal bogies, ear cones and all, you'll be having some oval shape, wedge shape, different types of shapes. You can see here. First and second image will talk about the shapes of suppositories. And second and third image will talk about different molds used in the preparation of suppository. Second and third image will talk about different molds used in the preparation of suppositories. Clear? All these things are for understanding, and the types of suppositories also is not there in your syllabus. But even though I am teaching you for your understanding, it is not like you study only the things that are present in the syllabus. Always you need to go beyond your syllabus and beyond your textbook. That is very important for, especially for Form D people. Next, ma, interesting topic, types of suppository bases. Next topic, types of suppository bases. As I told you, any base to be selected or any excipient to be selected in any formulation, for example, in tablets, you will be having different types of excipients. In liquids, you will be having different types of excipients. In the same way, in suppository also, you will be having different types of excipients. The main excipient for your suppository will be your suppository bases. Okay, so any excipient in any dosage form, you need to know what are the ideal properties of that particular excipient used in the formulation. In the same way, do you remember while dealing with your theoretical aspects of liquid dosage form, we have discussed each and every theoretical aspect. When you talk about glycerin, glycerin is this, glycerin have this nature, glycerin will be having co-solvent property, glycerin is used as a sweetening agent. All these are nothing but some properties of your excipient. In the same way, for your suppository, you need to know what are the ideal property of a suppository base to be added to a suppository formulation. Okay, what are the properties? First one, any suppository base selected should melt at body temperature. That is very important here. Okay, any suppository base selected should melt at body temperature. Second one, it has to dissolve or disperse in body fluids. What is the second step? It has to dissolve or disperse in body fluids. What we have discussed previously, ma, what is the mechanism of suppository? Immediately after inserting into the rectum, it has to melt, it has to soften, after that it has to dissolve. Here the same thing, a suppository base should have an ideal property, the second ideal property, like it has to dissolve or disperse in body fluids. The third one, release any medicament readily. It should not withhold the medicament. So if you can remember the preparation of suppository, first you will be melting the base, right? After melting the base, you will be adding your drug to the base. So after adding the drug to the base, what you will do? You will start mixing the base. Okay, on mixing the base, ultimately your drug will get dispersed into the base. So after that, you will be pouring into a suitable mold. After that, you are going to solidify it. That is nothing but subjecting to a refrigeration. Now your suppository is ready in a particular bullet shape. So when this bullet shape inserted into your rectal cavity, this particular suppository should be in a position to release the medicament readily. It should not, your base should not withhold your API. Okay, next, what is the fourth property? Retain its shape when handled. Okay, as I told you, when you are taking that particular suppository from a packet, ultimately it has to retain its shape, okay, till the point of insertion. When it is not able to retain its shape, ultimately it is a failure of your suppository preparation. In laboratory, you have prepared different types of suppository, different batches prepared different types. There are some suppositories which are half filled, there are some suppositories immediately after taking into the hand, they are just getting liquefied. So that is nothing but that particular suppository should hold a property like it has to retain its shape when handled. Next, that particular suppository base should be non-toxic and non-irritant to the mucous membrane. It should not cause any toxicity to the mucous membrane and it should not irritate your mucous membrane. Next, ideal property. It should be stable on storage. For any suppository, what you will do, you will just allot the shelf life. That is nothing but storage. Okay. When you fix the shelf life, it should be able to maintain its stability on storage. Next, it should be compatible with all medicaments. When you say it should be compatible, this is a very good concept. Many times I have discussed, any excipient you add it to your drug, that particular excipient should be compatible with your drug. It should be compatible within the excipient present in the formulation. It should be compatible with the packaging, that your container or packet, wherever you are going to pack. Next, it should be stable above its melting point. Okay, so what is the melting point of your body temperature? It is around 35 to 37 degrees. Okay, so that is the melting point of your suppository. But here it says that a suppository base added to your formulation, it should be stable above its melting point. Okay, next, easily moldable. What do you mean by easily moldable? It is a, if you can see the preparation of suppository, how beauty it is. So it is getting liquefied immediately on liquefied content. Just you are going to pour it into the mold immediately within seconds, 5 to 10 seconds, everything will start setting. That is nothing but solidification will happen. So that is nothing but easily moldable property. And next one is, should not adhere to the mold. It is very important, ma. What we do in our laboratory, in order not to make your suppository base to get adhered to your mold, you will be adding something called as glycerin onto the suppositories. That is nothing but called as lubrication of your molds, ma. Okay, why you do lubrication of the molds? Because as this base, there is a chance that it may adhere to the molds. Even though you lubricate, in some instances, your base will be adhered to your mold. When the base get adhered to your mold, ultimately you can say that particular base used in the preparation of suppository is not correct base, because it is not holding the ideal property. Like, it should, that particular base should not adhere to the mold. These are your ideal suppository base. So for any excipient, for any base, anything you add it to your formulation, ideal properties are very important. Clear? Yeah. Coming to the, there are four main types of bases are available. Okay. Please make a note, everyone. Four main types of bases are available. The first one is oily bases. Okay. Under that, cocoa butter base, emulsified theobroma oil base, synthetic heart fat, otherwise called as hydrogenated oils. I repeat, cocoa butter base, emulsified theobroma oil base, and synthetic heart fat, otherwise called as hydrogenated oils. Second category is hydrophilic bases. In that, glycerinated gelatin base or glycerogelatin base. It is also called as glycerogelatin base. And second one, polyethylene glycols, otherwise called as macrogols, and soap glycerin. All these three comes under the category of hydrophilic bases. And the third category is water dispersible bases. Third category is water dispersible bases. And the fourth category is emulsifying bases. And the fourth category is emulsifying . Okay, totally these are four types of bases. Going on to the first one, oily bases. Going to the first one, oily bases or oligogenous or fatty bases. Under that, the first one, cocoa butter. First one, cocoa butter. So what is this? It is the most widely used suppository base. It is often used in compounding prescription when no base is specified. What is the most commonly used base in the preparation of suppositories? It is a cocoa butter base. It comes under the category of oily bases or oleaginous or fatty bases. It is often used in the compounding prescription when no base is specified. For example, a formulator has come to you and is saying that perform an experiment on suppository, prepare a suppository and submit. So he told phenol is the drug. Okay, now prepare the suppository. Now here the base has been not specified. In such conditions, immediately you need to cling on to your base called as cocoa butter base. Why? The reason is it is the most widely used suppository base. It satisfies many of the requirements for an ideal base. In the last slide, we saw what are the ideal properties of the suppository base, right? So out of all 8 to 10 ideal properties that we have depicted over there, we have discussed over there. So this particular cocoa butter will satisfy many of the requirements that are required for a base to act as an ideal base. So that is the reason cocoa butter is the most widely used suppository base. So what is cocoa butter? Cocoa butter is defined as the fat. It is called as a fat obtained from roasted seed of Theobroma cocoa. Theobroma cocoa is a plant. Okay. A plant will contain different parts. From that different parts, seed is the part from where. So it is not a normal seed. That seed should be roasted. From the roasted seed where you will be extracting a fat. Okay. That fat is nothing but called as your cocoa butter. Are you clear? Theobroma cocoa is nothing but a plant. Plant contains seeds. That seed should be roasted. So from the roasted seed, you will be extracting something called as fat. That fat is nothing but called as cocoa butter. Normally, what is a butter? Butter is nothing but a fat. Okay. So chemically, it is primarily a triglyceride with the predominant glyceride chains being oleopalmitostearin and oleodiesterin. Okay. What cocoa butter chemically? Chemically, it is a triglyceride. When you say triglyceride, nothing but it consists of three glyceride chains. Okay, in that three glyceride chains, there are two predominant glyceride chains that are important for your cocoa butter. What are the two predominant glyceride chains? One is oleopalmitostearin and the other one is oleodiesterin. Okay, next, it is a yellowish white solid brittle fat. So the color of cocoa butter is yellowish white, okay, and the nature is solid and it is a brittle fat. And what is the taste and smell? The taste and smell is like a chocolate, okay. As cocoa butter can easily melt and rancidify, okay, this cocoa butter has the property called as it easily melts because it is one of the ideal property where a particular suppository base should hold because any base should easily melt. Okay, melting is one condition. Okay, and apart from this melting condition, this cocoa butter has one disadvantage that it will get easily rancidified. Rancidify is nothing but acidification of your cocoa butter. Rancidification of your cocoa butter. On rancidification, how this rancidification will occur, you know, by absorbing the moisture or oxygen that is present in the environment, it will undergo rancidification. On rancidification, ultimately your cocoa butter will end up foul smelling. Okay, so if that things are associated with cocoa butter, you need to be very careful while storing your cocoa butter. It must be stored in cool, dry place and protected from light. That's the reason not only your cocoa butter, any container when you open for weighing the contents from the container, immediately you need to have a habit of tighten the container. Okay, that should be done first, then you need to go for weighing. This is most important because you don't know the property of the chemicals that you are going to handle. So in the case of cocoa butter, it will easily melt towards the external temperature and it will undergo rancidification. In such conditions, just you need to immediately tighten the cap and you need to just ensure that particular container should be stored in cool and dry place and it should be protected from light. Next, what are the advantages here of your cocoa butter? The melting range is 30 to 36 degree centigrade. Easily melts in the body. As the melting range is It readily melted on warming, rapidly settling on cooling. Okay, and the one other property of your cocoa butter is that it readily melts on warming. Okay, when you warm it, it will readily melt, and at the same time, it will rapidly set on cooling. So there is two properties associated with your cocoa butter. One is melting, the other one is settling. Both are important for the preparation of your suppositories. When you heat it, it should readily melt. When you cool it, it should readily go for settling. Clear? Next advantage, it should be miscible with many other ingredients. It should be miscible with many other ingredients. This is an important. Miscibility is nothing but it should be compatible with many other ingredients. And the last advantage, this cocoa butter base is non-irritating in nature. The base is non-irritating in nature. These are the advantages associated with your cocoa butter. As I said, for anything you talk about advantage, ultimately you will be having something called as disadvantages. So what are the disadvantages of your cocoa butter? The first disadvantage is polymorphism. What do you mean by the term polymorphism? Change of one form to the other forms. One form will change into different form. Such condition is called as polymorphism. Your cocoa butter is more prone towards the polymorphism. Can you say me some polymorphs? Alpha morph, beta morph, and gamma morph. Okay, there are stable polymorphs, unstable polymorphs, and metastable polymorphs. In the previous classes, if you can remember, I have discussed specially about polymorphism. Stable, unstable, and metastable. I think I have discussed in your emulsions topic. Okay, so one disadvantage associated with your cocoa butter is polymorphism. Why polymorphism will occur, you know? Because of the varying temperature. Because you will be melting your cocoa butter to high temperature like 30 to 35 degrees. Okay, after melting again you will be subjecting to refrigeration temperature for cooling. So in this particular melting and cooling process, your cocoa butter may convert into different polymorphs. So if it is a stable polymorph, it is well and good. If it gets converted into an unstable or metastable, your entire formulation will be in trouble. Okay, that is the first disadvantage of your cocoa butter. The second one, adherence to the mold. What is the ideal property we have discussed? Any suppository base that have been added to the formulation should not adhere to the mold. But there is a problem with the cocoa butter. In your laboratory, you would have observed, there are some suppositories, even though you have applied the glycerin, that particular base is adhering to your mold. That is one aspect of your cocoa butter. That is a disadvantage of your cocoa butter. Next, low softening point. Okay. This cocoa butter has low softening point. No need to explain about this softening point and all. Next, melting point reduction. There is a high melting point reduction for your cocoa butter. Even though the melting point has been given as 30 to 35 degrees on heat.
Unable to hear, sir.
Yeah, where I have stopped? Can you hear me?
Cocoa butter has low melting point on that
tensor.
Yeah, where I stopped now? Can anyone?
Cocoa butter have high melting point.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you, ma'am. As cocoa butter is having high melting point, as I mentioned you, 30 to 35 degrees, even though they have mentioned that melting point, but I don't know what is the problem. There is a disconnecting. Okay, even though they are having high melting point, okay, sometimes on heating, the melting point will get reduced. That is nothing but one disadvantage of your cocoa butter. Next, sir. Deterioration during storage. This cocoa butter is heavily prone for degradation. Why it is prone for degradation, you know? Any base used in the preparation of suppository, it's a fat. Fat is nothing but fat contains what? Glyceride. When compared to all the bases that are present, your cocoa butter is more prone for deterioration during storage. Next, poor water. Next one is poor water absorbing capacity. Your cocoa butter has poor water absorbing capacity. So when this particular disadvantage is associated, what happens exactly, you know? After placing your suppository into the rectum, it has to absorb the moisture.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah, yeah, I got it, ma. There is some disconnecting problem. I don't know what is there. Yeah, poor water absorbing capacity. Okay. So, even though, so this particular poor water absorbing capacity, what it is exactly, you know, after taking the suppository, you are going to insert the suppository into the rectum. Inside the rectum, your suppository will start melting due to the temperature, and your suppository also will intake the moisture that is present in the rectum. But your cocoa butter is weak in absorbing the water that is present in the rectum. Water is nothing but moisture that is present in the rectum. That is other disadvantages for your cocoa butter. Next problem, leakage from the body. So even though you have prepared from the prepared a perfect suppository, after inserting into the rectum, there is a chance that during insertion everything will feel good. Okay, after inserting, there is a chance that that particular suppository will crumble and will start leaking from the rectum. What we expect is that any suppository that is inserted into the rectum, it has to take the temperature on which it has to start melting slowly, thereby it has to soften, thereby it has to dissolve. This is what we expect with the mechanism of suppository. But unfortunately, when you use cocoa butter as a base, there is a chance that immediately after inserting into the rectum, it will start leaking from the rectum. Okay, these are the disadvantages associated with your cocoa butter base. Okay, next type of base is emulsified theobroma oil. Here I want to be clear that cocoa butter and theobroma oil both are same, both are common words. The difference between your cocoa butter base and emulsified theobroma oil base is the name. Can you find any difference? Cocoa butter is otherwise called as theobroma oil. Excuse me. So cocoa butter is otherwise called as theobroma oil. But here again we are discussing in under some other subheading called as emulsified theobroma oil. What is the difference between both? The only difference is the name. Here emulsified is there. That means that it's a common sense kind of a thing, that there is something added to your cocoa butter where it will become your emulsified theobroma oil. What is added? An emulsifying agent added to your cocoa butter will become a base called as emulsified cocoa butter or emulsified theobroma oil. So why there is a need to add an emulsifying agent to cocoa butter, we'll see now. In order to promote the diffusion of your active medicinal agent to the surrounding tissue and its subsequent absorption, several agents have been used to form emulsified theobroma oil suppositories. So what is the necessary for us to add some emulsifying agent to your cocoa butter? The main thing is that what is your suppository? You'll take suppository and you'll insert into the rectum. What happens there? It will just melt. After that, it will soften. After that, it will dissolve. After dissolving, what is happening here? It is permeating through your mucous membrane and entering into your systemic circulation. You're clear with the mechanism, right? what is happening, what is the principle involved in permeation, you know, the principle involved in permeation is diffusion process. What is the principle involved in the permeation? Diffusion process. Hope you have remembered about diffusion process, ma. Fick's first law of diffusion. Do you remember? Diffusion process can be explained with an equation called as Fick's first law of diffusion. So what do you mean by diffusion now? Movement of a particular substance from a region of higher concentration to the region of lower concentration. This is the principle of diffusion, right? So where is the higher concentration and where is the lower concentration? Here. So the rectal cavity containing your suppository will hold higher concentration. Why? Because drug is present over there. And other side of your mucous membrane, something present called as your blood vessel, right? So the blood vessel contains lower concentration. So always the drug moves from your rectal cavity and it will permeate through the mucous membrane through a process called as diffusion. Then it will enter into something called as systemic circulation. So in order to promote such particular type of diffusion, okay, so what we need to do, you need to add some emulsifying agent to your formulation. Then you can prepare something called as emulsified trimethylbromo oil suppository. So here the point has been clear, ma. The addition of an emulsifying agent to cocoa butter, not only it promotes the diffusion, but also makes melting unnecessary since the suppository will swell and disintegrate in the presence of moisture. So as I told you that cocoa butter base, you know, there is a disadvantage. What is the disadvantage? Before going into the rectum, it will just crumble itself and it will start leaking. That means that it is not holding good melting point here. As it is not holding good melting point, when you add emulsifying agent to your cocoa butter, what happens here? It will take some activity here. What is that activity? That unnecessary melting will not be done with the cocoa butter. Rather than that, it will go for swelling and disintegrating in the presence of moisture that is present in the rectum. Did you understand the concept, ma? What is the purpose of emulsifying agent? The first purpose to promote the diffusion of your active pharmaceutical ingredient. And the second purpose, already we have discussed in the disadvantage, that these particular cocoa butter based suppositories will readily melt and it will start leaking from the rectum. So when you add emulsifying agent to your cocoa butter, what happens here? It will reduce the melting point. When it reduces the melting point, ultimately what happens? That unnecessary melting will not happen. And rather than that, what it will do? It will just absorb the moisture that is present in the rectum and it will just swell and it will start disintegrating. Thus, the melting point may be raised without fear of interfering with disintegration. This is how your emulsifying agent in cocoa butter will help you to have an advantage over your normal cocoa butter. Are you clear with the concept of emulsified theobroma oil? Very simple, ma. One, diffusion, next unnecessary melting point, thereby it will swell and it will disintegrate in the presence of moisture. Okay. And the third one is synthetic hard fat or hydrogenated oils, ma. And the third type of oily base or oligogenous or fatty bases is synthetic hard fat or hydrogenated oils. The first point, synthetic hard fat bases are prepared by first hydrolyzing the vegetable oil, then hydrogenating the resultant fatty acids, and finally re-emulsifying the acids by heating with glycerol. So here we need to know how this synthetic hard fat can be manufactured. Okay, so this particular synthetic hard fat can be manufactured by, what is the first step involved? The first step, you need to hydrolyze the vegetable oil. After hydrolyzing the vegetable oil, you will be getting a fatty acids. That fatty acids should be subjected for hydrogenating. After subjecting for hydrogenating, you will be getting some acids. So that particular acids to be re-emulsified by heating with glycerol. This is a procedure involved in synthetic hard fat preparation. First, hydrolyzing the vegetable oil. There you will be getting some fatty acids. then hydrogenating. After hydrogenating, you need to go for re-emulsification of the acids. Then after re-emulsification, the fourth step, what you need to do, you need to just heat the acids with glycerol. Then your synthetic heart fat is ready. Examples of your synthetic heart fat are hydrogenated palm kernel oil. It is used in tropical countries as a base for suppositories. Okay, especially this particular synthetic heart fat will be used in the preparation of suppository in some countries like tropical countries. Okay, and the example for that synthetic heart fat is hydrogenated palm kernel oil. Hydrogenated palm kernel oil is an example for synthetic heart fat. Next, what are the advantages of these bases over your theobroma? So now we have discussed something about synthetic heart fat, right? We know about cocoa butter now, we know about emulsified theobroma oil, we know the advantages and disadvantages about your cocoa butter and theobroma oil. Okay, now in what way your synthetic heart fat bases are advantages over your theobroma oil or cocoa butter base? Okay, first one, their solidifying points are unaffected by overheating. Even though you go for overheating, the solidifying points will not be affected for synthetic heart fat. But in the case of your cocoa butter, there is a chance of polymorphism. As I told you, overheating will result in polymorphism. It may end up in stable, unstable or metastable. But in the case of synthetic heart fat, such problems can be overcome. Okay. Second point, they have good resistance to oxidation because their unsaturated fatty acids have been reduced. And as I told you, when you leave cocoa butter for a prolonged period of time to the atmosphere, ultimately the oxygen that is present in the atmosphere will come and interact with your cocoa butter and it will result in rancidification. But here, in the case of synthetic heart fat, it will not happen. Why? Because the free unsaturated fatty acids that are present in your synthetic heart fat have been reduced. So always remember, there are fatty acids that are present in your any type of base. When you say there are free unsaturated fatty acids, there are binded unsaturated fatty acids. Always there will be a problem for the fatty acids that are free. Okay, if they are binded enough, no problem. If they are free, ultimately they will prone to oxidation. In the case of your synthetic heart fat, the unsaturated free fatty acids have been reduced. That's the reason the oxidation reaction will not occur in the case of synthetic heart fat. The third one, the difference between a melting and setting points is small, generally only 1 to 2 degrees. Okay, always remember, in the preparation of suppositories, two things will happen. One is melting, the other one is setting. What do you mean by melt? On melting, it will get liquefied. On setting, it will get solidified. These things are very important. And this particular melting and setting point is very small in the case of synthetic heart fat. It is, a difference is about 1 to 2 degrees. Okay, more than 1 degree or less than 1 degree, it will just degrade your melting and setting points. Okay, the difference is very small, 1 to 2 degrees. So, utmost care should be taken while preparing any suppository using your synthetic heart fat, and seldom over 3 degree centigrade. So, when you go to the 3 degree centigrade, ultimately you will just degrade your suppository preparation. You are going to get the formulation of suppository. When the setting point of base is well below the melting point, the suppository soften quickly when handled and become too slippery to administered. So whenever the setting point of base is well below the melting point, so for every base you will be having some melting point. For example, the melting point is 35 degree for synthetic heart fat, you assume that. So when the setting point is below your 35 degrees, ultimately that particular suppositories will soften quickly when handled and become too slippery to administer. There will be a problem that, so you cannot handle the suppository, at the same time you cannot insert into the rectum, because as it softens, it will be slippery to touch, and even you cannot put some pressure onto the suppository and you cannot insert into the rectum. This is a problem with your synthetic heart fat. Okay. What is the reason? Because the difference between your melting and setting point is very small. Generally, it is about 1 to 2 degrees. Next, fourth point, they usually contain a proportion of partial glycerides, some of which are, example, glyceryl monostearate are water in oil type of emulsifying agent, and therefore their water absorbing capacities are very good. As I said you that in the advantage of your synthetic hard fat, their water absorbing capacities are very good. Why the water absorbing capacities are very good, you know, here again it contains some emulsifying agent. That emulsifying agent is nothing but glyceryl monostearate. It is a water in oil type of emulsifying agent. Do you remember in the previous slides when we are discussing with your emulsified cocoa butter or emulsified theobroma oil, I said you one point. The water absorbing capacities are very good for emulsified theobroma oil. Why? What is the difference between an emulsified theobroma oil and your cocoa butter? Cocoa butter, the water absorbing capacity is very poor. But in the case of emulsified theobroma oil, the water absorbing capacity is very good. Okay. What is the difference here? Here the melting point is very high. As you have added emulsifying agent to the formulation, the melting point, there is no need to worry about unnecessary melting point reduction. Ultimately, it will just soften. It will absorb the moisture. It will just soften and it will start disintegrating. This is the advantage we discussed under emulsified theobroma oil or cocoa butter. Here also the same. As it contains a water in oil type of an emulsifying agent called as glyceryl monostearate, their water absorbing capacities are good. Okay, so that's all about your oily bases or oligogenous bases or fatty acids. So tomorrow exactly at 1 o'clock again we will have a discussion for remaining bases. What are the left bases? Left three types of bases we will discuss tomorrow. Thank you very much, and please ensure that to send